So what actually goes into creating and designing a laser tag arena?
Oh, well, so that's it's a fun question. We really start with the initial concept or a theme. One of the things that we try to do regularly is focus on story-driven and immersive experiences within a laser tag. So whether it's something that we're taking inspiration from popular movies and pop culture or video games, we really like to nerd out. And so in order to even start to design a laser tag arena, you've got to have some good nerd credentials in place, which is always helpful. From there, it's really always a balance between artistry and engineering. And so we really want to focus on something that's going to be visually stunning, but still adheres to local codes and ordinances, whether that's through material specs or fire retardants or ingress and egress required of a space. And then how do we still create fun, cool, exciting paths with our maze panels throughout all of that? So looking at then where do we want to have certain targets and certain interaction points, and how do we create stuff for folks to play against on a Tuesday afternoon in order to have a very dense playing experience. So, if there's not a full 24 other players in that space like on a Saturday, then they still have enough meat on the bone to sink their teeth into as well. So starting then with, okay, bases and center props and targets that can be interacted with other key areas, starting to place those and then laying in things like the maze panels themselves. Finally, because we have to have that ADA compliance and we need that to be, custom fit into whatever orientation or shape that we have. So those are all some of the design side, the logistics side of developing a laser tag concept, as well as working with architects and general contractors and helping them understand kind of, hey, this is how a space, a frame or a shell needs to be built out as well. So that way it gives us the best options. We don't want something that's less than 25 or 30 feet because that becomes really narrow. We need something that's, ideally rectangular if we can get it, just because it allows for longer passages of traffic and more exciting gameplay for folks to be able to have off. And so it's moving levers and knobs kind of all at the same time to make sure that we have a good infrastructure, we have a good finished product, but all of that works together nicely from a good cohesive artistic piece too.
Do you have base themes that you start with before you begin customizing? Mm-hmm. And how many, and how does that work?
So we have, I'd say we have upwards of 14 or 15 different kind of starting points. I would say, so one of the things that we really like to do is, we want every arena to have its own unique elements and combination of things. So what we do is we've built this wonderful, beautiful catalog of just different looks over time where, I have a Wild West feel, or I have a kind of a cemetery type of a feel, or I have, a Wizard Knight's Quest kind of a feel, or I have something that's, very Destiny 2 kind of inspired or sci-fi. And so we have a number of those different starting points that then have any combination of multiple murals that kind of fall within that category. So different props that could be part of it. And what we really like to do is find something that one of those starting points where a client can say, hey, this is not something that anybody else in my market would have to start with, which is great. So I'm not splitting hairs to try and differentiate. So if someone else has kind of a spaceship inspired, sci-fi-esque type of laser tag arena, I know that I want to go to something very different, unique, just to have something else to offer the market. But then from there, it's, we have, you get a number of different floor props. Of these 10 floor props, which ones would you prefer to have in your space? And so having this almost build your sandwich visual customization path that we walk through with them once we know what the space is going to be and how many players we want to play for and all of that, really giving a ton of different customization processes of, yes, I like this type of finish, but I want this color palette and I want these props, but I also want to take this thing from this other theme entirely and start to swap it in. So there's plenty of things that we can do where, you start with 15 core bases and then you have all of these different base styles and props and artwork and everything that they can do. And it's hundreds of thousands of combinations at that point for every arena to have something really unique. Not to mention then the Easter eggs that we'll put in that are tailored for the owners as a little thank you to them, whether that's a kid's name on a street sign of one of the owners or a local landmark that they really like that would like to incorporate. So there's tons of stuff that we can do to keep that open. And so there's really not a limit on the number of themes we can do.
How many laser tag arenas are currently operating with a Creative Works design, and how much of the market share do you hold?
I would say I probably have to adjust that to each year we typically will do about 60 to 70% of the new arenas that are built. You know, leading up into 2019, it was not uncommon for those 5 years, you know, 2014 to 2019, about 100 new laser tag arenas would be built each year. And then over the last 2 years, we've seen some of that slow, obviously, for the larger elements of COVID and our industry that's had to adjust to that. But I would say, I mean, it's with what we've done here in the States and what we've done internationally, I mean, there's easily, you know, we're coming up on 1,000 laser tag arenas here before too long. Which is quite a mark. We're looking forward to it.
With so many arenas using your designs, what do you do to keep things fresh and to make things unique between the arenas that use similar themes?
Sure. So that obviously comes down to our artists each time doing things that keep it fresh for them, right? Because if they were stepping and repeating, doing the same thing over and over again, they would get burnout on some of that. And so whether it's within the mural work, giving them the flexibility of, look, these are the key visuals that we want within the space. But then how do you use the space to your advantage as a true canvas and give you that opportunity to start tailoring? But then it will be everything from small details of weathering and distortions that they'll put on a maze panel. It will be, you know, fun new content and new explosions or helicopters and things where they'll get to pick and choose some of the visual elements that they want to also step up from, you know, here are the base level things that we always have to have. And then they have kind of a grab bag of here's some of the unique pieces. So that way they can really have that authenticity for each space to really bring out the best of it every time.
What are a few of the most distinctively unique arenas that Creative Works has done and what makes them stand apart?
Well, you know, we've had the opportunities to do just some crazy over-the-top arenas. And so one of the first ones that I think was really the jump into just a next level of theming that we started to get into was probably for Big Thrills. And so down in Florida, it's in the Destin market. But gosh, what a cool opportunity where that was the first time we started doing much more of a Lara Croft Tomb Raider, Indiana Jones, Temple of Doom kind of a vibe. But we had these humongous snake heads that were coming up, these beautiful cobras, and doing these larger than life kind of architectural structures to show these old aqueducts and things. And so that one I love just because the true artistic interpretation of what a space like that would have been, but just the visual impact of what it was amazing. So that one would definitely be up there as a pioneer of its time, for sure. I think that another one on the West Coast that we did that is much more focused around, we have a Yeti / Bigfoot that's in there because it's all about this timber mining type of a theme. And so the center prop is a conveyor belt for a huge log, and everything, you know, the landscapes and everything that are painted are the beautiful Pacific Northwest. And so two just very different styles, color palettes and approaches, but really amazing props, really killer target integrations with those. But the one that I think probably gets me the most excited would have been Big Cedar Lodge. And the reason for that one was the level of target integration into the props themselves was just, again, really set the new standard for what a truly, you know, high caliber immersive experience can be. Think like Big Buck Hunter came to life with laser tag, because again, you're walking through, all of a sudden the DMX programming is highlighting a black bear that's coming out at you, and so now you're tagging and at the bear that has the targets built into its chest. And so there's just much more of that interaction between the components and the prop work and the targets that really set that apart, and the customization and the level of theming that they put into that project through us. It's a beautiful piece. It's technically ecstatic, and we're just thrilled with how that one came out with.
What details do you think make the biggest difference in an arena?
I think it's the little details. One of the things that we always focus on is, you know, how do we consistently create a repeatable, strong playing experience? And so we know roughly how and where we're going to orient the bases and the center props and the major components every time, just to ensure that we have best practices in line there. But really, it's the small attention to detail that can be brought out in the mural work. It's the selection of a new custom prop or something that just really resonates with the story that we're trying to tell or the experience that we're trying to create. And so for me, it's where are those moments of authenticity or realistic things that either resonate with the local community. So whether it's an Apex, you know, park in Syracuse where we're doing local landmarks, and really making that feel genuine to the local populace, Or it's where and how we would engineer a target to be built into a prop, just so that way it does feel like you're, you know, blowing up an Apache helicopter that's flying out of the wall at you. And so it's the angles and the artistic decisions, I think, a lot of times that really help bring that, you know, what looks good on paper all of a sudden looks magnificent in person.
What are some of the premium touches that take things up a notch from basic to premium?
I would say that there's always a room for, additional prop work so we can build the targets themselves into the props. Sometimes what folks will do as you get later into a process and you have all of the constraints of a project as a whole, they may want to reduce some of the prop work and just put the targets up on the walls themselves and have them blend into the mural work, or it looks a little bit kind of slapdash. And it's no fault of either person. There's different, you know, ways to make that work well every time. But I think that's one of the little things that all of a sudden, where can we have more immersion by having these things truly unified in a blended way, the targets and the components themselves. That, I think, starts to make much more of a seamless flow. I'm not pulled out of the experience. I'm not noticing that there's wiring, you know, up on the wall. Everything just looks clean and smooth, and it doesn't take me out of the story that I'm trying to be the main character of.
What one piece of advice would you give to a new operator who's thinking about putting in a laser tag arena?
So one is plan for patience and give yourself, just for your project as a whole, probably about 20% more budget than what you were expecting if you're doing a reno or something along those lines. Just because, again, having some reserves with you know, zoning and general contractor stuff, that's always something that I recommend just at large for most of our clients, because it's something that we typically see comes up on the general construction side, being as fluid as it is. The other piece that I would say for anyone is look at how you're creating an actual experience with your laser tag arena. So again, all of these wonderful attractions that we make can only go so far if the staff isn't present and engaged and working with the guests as they're going through to make that something really special. It is the very much necessary other side of the coin. And so while we would love to take credit of our arenas will sell themselves and do all of these things, like, yes, it will if they're being operated at a high level of engagement. And so your staff and putting time into how are we going to create new games and new experiences and new styles of play within our for our guests regularly, keeps it fresh for your staff so they're not getting bored doing the same old thing. Keeps it fresh for your regulars and your parties, but really helps the guests feel heard and crafted towards. You know, that boutique experience really comes from staff engagement, and laser tag can do that all day long in spades if we're just a little bit intentional about what we want to do from the guest experience side.
Any final thoughts you'd like to share about what Creative Works has to offer?
We are just really blessed to have a bunch of mad scientists that we've either stolen from Disney or trained in their likeness. And so when folks ask what we do, I start to go into this weird tangent of, well, we do attractions, but, you know, we custom build all of it. And essentially what I've distilled it down into is we're the Willy Wonka meets Ferrari for family entertainment attractions. So we really get to have a lot of fun. What comes at us every single day is, how is this going to make a positive memory for someone looking to escape or celebrate, you know, a time in their life? And knowing that what we're doing is putting some good in the world that way is always a plus. And so thank you for those of you that play our attractions and continue to make those memories, because that's what we do it for.